First of all, it's a complicated year, complicated quarter, fourth quarter of 2019, because you had the strike. Give us apples to apples. How can we measure this? How should an investor look at it?
Sure. If you look at the whole calendar year, David, we had $4.82 of EPS. And when you adjust that for the impact of the strike, as you just talked about, it was closer to $6.71. So strong performance from core operations. And when you also look at the calendar year 2020, as we go forward, we expect that momentum to continue. And particularly on the cash side, where we've had a lot of focus in that area, we're expecting a strong cash flow in 2020, building off a strong 2019, where we generated $6.5 billion when you adjust for the impact of the strike. So we're doing that with our strong launches. Our trucks are performing really well. Our crossovers are doing very well. And the cost savings that we've put in place as well have helped us mitigate some of the macro impact that we're seeing around the globe.
Sticking with the United States for a moment, North America, talk about the product mix, because you will in 2020 have a full year of your full-size pickups. The SUVs are just coming in later. How does that affect the results we should expect from GM next year?
Sure, so we are going to have a full year of light duties. We're going to have a full year of heavy duties as well. On the SUV side, we're transitioning now from the old platform to the new platform. We do expect to take some downtime for that, and that's factored into our overall results, and we expect to see the strength in light duty and heavy duty continue, and when the full-size SUVs are up and running, we expect to see a strong momentum from that. We launched it yesterday, and it had great reception, so we're very excited about that product.
So momentum, tailwind from some new products. What about headwinds from softness in the market overall in North America? What are you looking at?
So we're expecting the industry to be slightly down, about 500,000 units, with that comes residual value pressures and our FinCo and so on. So we expect macro to be slightly softer in the United States, and that would basically be offset by the specific performance of our company, where we have unique catalysts that are going to help us in 2020. So that would offset the macro impact.
To what extent do you have the ability to really monitor costs, limit costs, even reduce costs in response to a soft market in North America, in part perhaps because of what happened because of the labor negotiations?
Well, we are laser focused on costs, and that's been the focus for many years now, and with the transformation that we rolled out in November of 2018, we're on track to achieve that. In the last year and a half, we've achieved about $3.3 billion. We're on track in 2020 to have another $1 billion of cost savings as well. So it's certainly contributing to the bottom line. And when you see a softer macro environment, that's how we're able to differentiate ourselves, where you have both strong products as well as a focus on cost.
General Motors is also very strong in China. Talk about 2019 in China. How did that look? How did you come in? What are you looking at 2020?
Yeah, 2019 was definitely softer. It was in line with our guidance that we provided when we saw the softness happening in the overall market. And we had about $1.1 billion of equity income in 2019. And you see the industry maturing, and it's going through a cycle. With that comes a price impact. So we're experiencing that together with the industry. And we're also exposed to some of the lower tier markets in China. So our disproportionate impact also reflects the fact that we have the Baojun brand and the Wuling brand, which operate more in the tier two, 3 to 5 cities. So with that, we're working on short-term business fixes as well as long-term. We're bullish on the market. We think we're greatly positioned, especially with Cadillac, that's been performing really well in China.
That's China overall. We can't talk about China right now without talking about the coronavirus. Give us a sense of how it is affecting General Motors. And first of all, with your employees, do you have manufacturing facilities in the area?
Yeah, we do have a presence in China. It's a fluid situation, David, as you see. Our focus now, as you point out, it's on our employees and making sure that they're okay. It's obviously a tough situation, and our thoughts are with everyone who's impacted. From a business standpoint, it has the demand impact in China as well as global supply chain implications that we're monitoring. Too early to tell from a demand standpoint. We do expect Q1 to be weaker in China as a result of the situation. And once we come out of it, we're expecting the operation to recover, but the team is working around the clock to ensure that we're mitigating what we can from the virus impact.
You're managing the quarter to quarter, the year to year, but we also have longer term trends in your business, electric vehicles. Mm-hmm. General Motors has made a big investment in electric vehicles. Give us a sense of where you are right now, and we couldn't talk about electric vehicles right now without talking about Tesla. Can you catch up with Tesla?
I would say we're all in on EVs. And the way we're demonstrating that, we have a number of key vehicle launches coming. You saw the Hummer EV announcement recently. And we have a number of other additional strong products that are coming as well. We're taking this seriously. We've made meaningful investments in this area. We have the Detroit Hamtramck plant we recently announced, which is going to be all EV. We have our partnership with LG that we've announced as well from a battery standpoint. We're excited about it. We think we're uniquely positioned. We have scale. We have multiple brands and segments where we're able to leverage our one flexible architecture and go all in and have very exciting products in a profitable position coming in as well. So in addition to the core business, we have this exciting growth opportunity. I think that positions us well to the future.
All in electric vehicles for General Motors. Give a sense of a market share. When you end up 3, 4, 5 years down the road, where do you think that you will end up? Because Tesla right now has like 17-18% of global EV market. It's a fairly limited market. Do you think you can take market share from them? Can you maintain General Motors' overall market share in electric vehicles?
I think the products will speak for themselves, and we'll have very strong products coming up. And, you know, the penetration is growing as well. It takes a period of time, and people have different assumptions on how quickly that's going to grow. But we do think this is a market that grows, and we will take our rightful share of that.
So finally, looking forward into 2020, what's the biggest upside risk? What's the biggest downside risk for General Motors?
On the upside, I would say, you know, the products that we have and the strength of them and how we're capitalizing on them, we're very excited on that momentum, and we're going to continue to build every unit we can and maximize the opportunity in front of us, as well as this putting proof points on EV and AV and all the growth areas that we have. We're very excited about that.
And downside?
And downside, look, it's a volatile business at the end of the day, and macroeconomically everywhere we're facing challenges, but we're going to, the team does well, we work on offsetting those and putting proof points on the board, so we're very excited about our future.